Okay.
Yeah, it says it's live on Facebook.
There we go. Perfect.
And right on time.
Yeah. Right on time. Thank
there
you.
There we are. I got it.
Awesome. Perfect.
I'm going to mute everybody just for sound quality.
And good morning, everybody. You know, sometimes technology is absolutely fabulous and other times it drives us a little bananas. And so we are just going to be grateful. And so just want you all to know, welcome to First Christian Church in Concord, California. We are one church in multiple locations as we gather together on Zoom and Facebook Live. We believe that everyone is an equal and beloved child of God who deserves deep and meaningful connections, a purpose-filled life, and love expressed through belonging, service, and justice. We are an inclusive and loving, open and affirming community of faith and action, seeking, serving, and celebrating Christ through open minds, willing hands, and committed hearts. We strive to be an anti-racist and pro-reconciling congregation, and we welcome everyone, regardless of race, color, ancestry, language, age, ability, gender, sexual or affectional orientation. No matter who you are, no matter where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. So welcome home. And happy Mother's Day to all the mothers. And Carrie, will you let us know the Zoom rules, as it were?
Yes, good morning, everyone. Happy Mother's Day to all of you. Just so you know, you guys have heard this before, but we are recording. If you would rather not be seen, you can turn off your video, no problem there. But this recording will be up later on our website. And we're also on Facebook Live. Good morning, everyone on Facebook. We're glad you're with us. If you're muted just now for sound quality, it just helps if everyone's muted. But we would love to hear from you. There's ways that you can do that. You can chat here in the chat box. In fact, I'm going to put the attendance link there. If you haven't yet, go ahead and fill out the attendance link. Let us know that you're here. You can give a reaction. There's a reactions button down at the bottom. You can give a little thumbs up or a heart for things that you love, or you can clap. You can also unmute yourself during prayers of the people and also during signs of life, which is coming up right after the very first song. So please engage with us. Let us know you're here. We'd love to hear from you this morning. And that's it. Happy Mother's Day. That's so beautiful.
All righty.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes. The only one who could ever say, worthy of with every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Beside you, open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. I will build my life upon. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
Amen. Ooh, I love that song. That was a good way to start off the morning. All right. This is the time of our service where you get to share how you've seen God working in your life or in the lives of people around you this past week or even before then. But anything anybody would like to share, go ahead and unmute yourself in chat. I'm scrolling through to see if I see any hands. Oh, Diana, I see you.
Good morning, everyone. I wanted to share that I got to video chat with my mother and sister again on Friday. Unfortunately, that meant I missed Judy's lunch and learn. But she also remembered Ellie and Judy and wanted to say hello to them. So in her dementia mind, she still remembers you all. So that was really nice. So it's just nice to see their faces. No, technology can be wonderful sometimes.
Yes, absolutely. I'm glad you got to do that this week. That's a huge sign of life. Anyone else?
I have one.
Does yes.
Hi. So hi. My Aunt Jo, who's she's my mom's youngest sister, 88 in Michigan, she had fluid in her around her heart and went into AFib, and we were really, really worried about her. They put her in the hospital and they kept saying, okay, tomorrow if she does well, she can go home. But then that day would come and she still wasn't doing well. And then she had trouble breathing and so forth. And of course my mind went to the worst place. I'm so worried, but she came home yesterday.
Oh,
yeah. And so all those prayers and everything, they worked. She's home, she's happy. My cousin, who hadn't seen her for more than a year, is taking care of her, and she's like, this is the best Mother's Day gift ever.
Oh, I love that. Thank you so much for sharing. That is a definite sign of life.
I have one.
Yes.
My friend that I asked for prayers and positive thoughts for received the best news ever. What they thought may have been spine and brain cancer, her lumbar puncture turned out totally negative, and she's in complete remission. So,
oh, amen. That is a blessing.
Big thank you to all the prayer warriors out there.
Yes. Oh, what a sign of life. Thank you for sharing, Janet. Love that. Anybody else want to share? All right, then I'm going to ask Ellie to start us off with the call to worship.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. God speaks to the heart, offering compassion and hope. God enlivens the mind, inviting curiosity and wonder. God awakens all spirits, creating unimaginable possibilities. God calls the whole world, inspiring extravagant love. Let us pray. Creating Spirit, we join with the chorus of all creation to celebrate your wondrous deeds. Fill us with your joy and train our ears for harmony so that we may contribute to the world you are already creating. All this we pray in the name of Jesus, who revealed what is possible through love. Amen. And now, as the next song plays, I invite you to light a candle. Lighting a candle is a sacred ritual. We light a candle for many purposes: to illuminate the darkness, to dedicate prayers, to offer blessings, and to give thanksgiving. We welcome you to this practice of lighting a candle and invite you to connect to your inner stillness and to our community. Slow your pace and offer these moments your full attention. Light your candle as a witness to the presence of the one who is the resurrection and the life.
Not boast. Love, after all, matters the most. Love does not run. Love does not hide. Love does not keep locked inside. Love is a river that flows through. Love never fails. Love will sustain. Love will provide. Love will not cease at the end of time. And love will protect. Love always hopes, and love still believes when you don't. Love is the arms that are holding you. Love never fails. Here, love is alive.
love is the way, the truth, the life. Love is the river that flows through. Love is the arms that are holding you. And love is a place you will fly to. Love never fails you.
Amen. Love never, ever, ever fails. God's love never, ever, ever fails. It is that time in our service where we have an opportunity to share with one another and with God our joys as well as our concerns. If you have something that you would like us to remember in prayer, a person or a situation, that you would like for us to lift up in prayer, please, you've got a couple of options. One is to put it in the chat so that we can make sure we capture it for the intersections for this coming week. The other is in a few moments to be able to share it out loud. You have those two options. The other is if you have a particular concern that's on your heart or on your mind that you only at this point you only want either me to know or the elders to know, please look for or type in my name or Carrie Little's name in the chat, and those will come up as direct messages to us, and we will get those and hold those concerns in our hearts. Today is Mother's Day, and it is a day that is filled with complexities. And I found a prayer that I think helps to speak to those complexities. So hear us as we pray. God of provision and unconditional love, on this day when we acknowledge the importance of motherhood among us, we first give thanks that you are a loving parent to us all. From your being, all life was born, and in your bosom, all creation is nurtured. You have formed us in your image as your children, and you have gathered us together as a brood under your wing. You have united us as kindred members of one human family. And we are grateful to be your offspring together. We celebrate your divine love, reflecting in human expressions of motherhood. We give you thanks for the mothers among us and ask that you strengthen them in their daily tasks. Grant them wisdom in the lessons they teach, patience in the discipline they foster, and persistence in their promotion of decency and compassion, both by word and example. May they be given the honor and thanks they deserve, but often do not receive. We thank you for all mothering figures, grandmothers, aunts, sisters, wives, stepmothers, bonus mothers, foster mothers, guardians, babysitters, teachers, healthcare providers, neighbors, friends, loved ones, and many others who practice self-sacrifice and embody compassion to all who are privileged to be in their influence. Grant them vigor to carry on their work and the satisfaction that the holy privilege of their tasks affords. We acknowledge to you, O God, that even amid our grateful celebration, many of us come with restless spirits, reluctant to name the difficulties of this day. For some, this day brings the sorrowful awareness of their own inability to conceive biological children. Draw your tender spirit near to their feelings of self-betrayal, impotence, and grief, and remind them that those who struggle with infertility have always shared a special place in your heart. We pray for those who have suffered miscarriages, those fatigued by fertility treatments, and those struggling through the process of adoption. May they remember that in your power and through your church, they can still leave a lasting legacy beyond themselves. For some, this day is marked by loneliness and grief as they spend this Mother's Day as a widower, an orphan, or a parent who has lost a child. To those who live today in the wake of the death of a loved one, grant glimpses of the resurrection. Bring to them a steady restoration of their broken hearts. Allow them to live into their future with hope and empower them to carry on the legacy of lessons instilled within them. For some, this is a day that surfaces ongoing tensions that exist within our personal relationships and family dynamics. We ask for healing from the wounds of our past, a path of forgiveness for wrongs both experienced and committed, and the rebuilding of trust forged in honesty, authenticity, and love. We give you thanks for the wide spectrum of motherhood represented among us today. New mothers and young mothers whose children are in their most tender years. Mothers of grown children who transition into empty nests and a new chapter of self-discovery. Mothers and grandmothers of advanced years whose twilight of life is marked by the frailty of body, but the potency of spirit. Theirs is a cumulative reminder that though our lives are marked by transition and change, your nurture and affection for all your children remains the same. Therefore, remind us to live with a childlike faith, curious to every mysterious, every wondrous mystery, attentive to your every instruction, obedient to your every command, and willing to share with every one of your children. We give you thanks, O God, who is a loving mother and father to us all, and in whose name we pray. Amen. We lift up today Scott and Sue Sumner Moore, who are traveling they're already there as they attend the memorial service for Scott's father. And we also lift up their nephew, Greg Moore, who has experienced some serious health concerns. Are there others that you would like to lift up before God and one another?
Tamia and Desire.
Phyllis Landberg.
Olo Duarme and Caleb.
The people of India.
Barb Neil Meyer.
Tony and Sharon Mitchell.
Troops are not able to be with their mother today.
Yes.
Max Cook.
For these prayers we offer in the name and in the spirit of Jesus the Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray and please use the words most familiar to you. Our Creator, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Well, Jacob is not with us today. He's spending time with his parents. And he has, as he said to us last week, there is no worship and wonder today so that the children can spend time with their parents. And so we are grateful for his witness, and we are grateful for the lessons he shares with the kids. And so we'll move right into the offering. As we remember Jesus, we are reminded of just how clearly his life demonstrated the truth that giving is the only proper expression of loving. Surely one can give without loving, but one cannot love without giving. So God loved the world so much that God gave God's only Son. But Jesus turned a corner in our understanding of the relationship between loving and giving when he indicated that not only does love result in giving, but giving also results in loving. He reminded us, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. In our stewardship, our conscientious Christian management of resources, we find our concern achieving a wider and wider circle to include all those in our embrace whose needs are alleviated by our giving. In giving, we are able to go to not only go where we go normally, but to go where we have never been, and to embrace those whom we have never met, and to express God's love to them in languages we have never learned. Our young ones love to sing, "God's got the whole world in God's hands." And when we follow God's leadership, demonstrated in the loving ministry of Jesus Christ, we discover that we've got the whole world in our arms, embraced with more than sentiment, and loved in more than words. Let us give with joy to the mission and ministry of our church. Thank you. Let us pray. We dedicate this money as one evidence of our stewardship, loving God. Our silver and gold have no value except as they are invested according to your purposes. Our lives gain value as we give our time and our talents in loving service. Use all that we have and all that we give to build the community you intend. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Today's scripture is John chapter 15, verse 9 through 17. As the Divine One loved me, I too loved you. Remain in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love, just as I kept God's commandments and remain in God's love. I have said these things to you so that my joy will be in you and your joy will be complete. This is my commandment. Love each other just as I have loved you. No one has greater love than to give up one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I don't call you servants any longer because servants don't know what their master is doing. Instead, I called you friends because everything I heard from God, I have made known to you. You didn't choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you could go and produce fruit and so that your fruit could last. As a result, whatever you ask the Divine One in my name, God will give you. I give you these commandments so that you can love each other.
Amen. Thank you, Chone. Many of you know that one of my side gigs is to officiate weddings. When I officiate a wedding, I often include something like, partner one and partner two, your marriage requires love, which is a word often used with vagueness and sentimentality. Yet we mean something very real when we bind ourselves in love. When we love, we see things other people do not see. We see beneath the surface and observe qualities that make this one different from and dearer than all the others. To see with loving eyes is to know inner beauty, and to be loved is to be seen as we are seen by no other. Such love means security. Another human being wants us, wants to share life with us, accepts us without qualification or reservation, not as perfect, but as human, with strengths and weaknesses. I go on to say lots of other wonderful things about loving one another. Knowing and trusting that on that day, on that wedding day, those two people are so hopeful and so filled with joy that they probably really don't hear what I'm saying, but the feeling is there. Well, today's passage is about love. God loves Jesus, Jesus loves us, therefore God loves us. We rest in the confidence of Jesus's love for us. And Jesus gives us two commandments, or maybe three, depending on how you count them. The first is to love God. The second is to love neighbor and love ourselves. And the third is kind of a reiteration of those, isn't it? To love one another as Jesus loves us. If we remain in Christ's love, if we follow Christ's commandments to love, we are Christ's disciples. Jesus will find joy in us, and we will find complete joy in our lives. And joy is a gift of and from God and a fruit of the Holy Spirit. Joy as a gift means that it must be given and received in order to be realized in our lives. We possess joy. It belongs to us. And as the saying goes, this joy that I have, the world can't take, the world didn't give it, and the world can't take it away. Joy comes from God. And God comes to us and stays with us. Jesus is God's love for us, incarnate, embodied, real, and tangible. All we need is love. It feels like that on a wedding day. It feels like that often while we are in church with one another. Sounds good so far, right? Well, gets a little more complicated in the next verse. No greater love, no one has greater love than this, than to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Love is not a sentimental hearts and roses kind of thing. This kind of love, real love, is a commitment. Love is a do word, as many of my friends like to say. Real love is unconditional. Jesus does not say, if you do what I say, then you will be my friends. Rather, he says, you are my friends. And because you are my friends, you will follow my commandments to love. Sounds easy, but it's not. Emily Askew writes, the definition of love here is the radical willingness to die, not for your child or a spouse, but for a fellow follower of Christ. Are we willing to lay down our lives, to stop doing the things that are in our own self-interest for those we love? Are we willing to lay down our lives, to give up some of our own privilege for those we love? Love means setting aside our bias. So what does it take to set aside all that one believes about others? To set aside the prejudices that prevent or stifle friendship in order to join others in being truly the body of Christ? How do we do those things so that we can really become the body of Christ? Well, we ask ourselves that and challenge each other as we grow in our own awareness and desire to be anti-racist. We do that and we challenge one another in our desire to be as inclusive as we possibly can. We know the power to change and grow is rooted in love. Love is the most difficult thing, but it is also the most necessary thing. Love is the antidote to human shortcomings, because the lack of love is often what constitutes the source of human shortcomings and harmful or toxic behaviors and attitudes. When someone treats us badly, it's rooted in the fact that they don't see our humanity. It's rooted in the fact that they don't recognize and love us as another human being. They don't have to be in love with us, but they have to love us. We have to love one another in a way that is different from being in love with one another. It is the power of God's love in the world that transforms lives, communities, and creation. Now, given the separation of cultures, races, class, and even political affiliation that seems to be taking over the majority of communities in the United States, this may be a great challenge for the body of Christ. But what we really need is love. Love can break through all of those barriers. As we look at the justice movements over the years, but specifically in the last few years, we see people willing to be arrested, to be beaten, or even killed for the cause of human integrity. Black and brown lives matter, stop Asian hate, trans lives matter, just to name a few. In those movements, in those protests, in those peaceful gatherings often, people, all people are gathered together to fight against injustice. People of color and white people, LGBTQ plus people and straight allies, Christians and non-Christians and people of no faith, all together, bound together by a love that is bigger than we can ever imagine. As a Christian, I'm going to say that it is bound together by the love of God, love of neighbor, and love of self. Love of self is not selfishness. It is not narcissism, but it is indeed the love that will not let us be trampled on. It is a love of self that means we are not allowing other people to victimize us. A love of self that is encompassed in self-respect and dignity. When we lay down our lives, we are God's love. We will venture from the safety of this sacrificial love that Jesus modeled, we will venture from safety of the community into the broader society to see that it is transformed by the sacrificial love that Jesus modeled for us. Theologian Dr. Cornel West says, "Never forget that justice is what love looks like in public. All we need is love." Jesus calls Christians to love each other. We first hear that commandment in John chapter 13, but Jesus knows it is so important for us to remember that no matter what confronts us, that we must love one another. And so he says it again and again and again. We hear it again because it is only against the backdrop of the world's hate that the radical nature of God's love is revealed in its fullest glory. We ought not assume, however, that what makes Jesus's love commandment, that this makes Jesus's love commandment easier to follow. It doesn't. Indeed, R. O'Day and Francis Taylor Gentch caution against dismissing its ethical seriousness. They say that the history of the church and of individual communities of faith suggests that to love one another may indeed be the most difficult thing Jesus could have ever asked. There are many circumstances in which it is easier to love one's enemies than it is to love those with whom one lives, works, and worships day after day. The intensity of the conflict, end quote, the intensity of the conflict in which many churches and denominations are engaged presently and perennially attest to the wisdom of their observations. Osvaldo Vega says, "Another implication of this passage and of Jesus's commandment has to do with the meaning of Jesus's death. According to this passage, at least, Jesus did not die as an atonement for the sins. According to this passage, at least, Jesus did not die as an atonement for sins, but as a proof of God's love toward humanity. One way to corroborate this idea is to notice, he says, is to notice that the institution of the Lord's Supper is missing from John's gospel, and it is replaced with the washing of the disciples' feet. a clear sign of Jesus's love for them. Jesus died as an example of the love, as an example of love taken to its most extreme and most radical manifestation. The greatest love of all, not as a payoff for people's sins, but of God's deep love for us. He says, I often wonder what the church would look like if its distinctive sign would have been the towel and basin rather than the cross and the empty tomb. Instead of redemptive suffering, which has justified so much bloodshed through the idea of Christus Victor, Jesus the Christ being the victor, from the Crusades to the conquest to the Holocaust, what we would have loved if we had had this image of the towel and the basin, that we would have love as our symbol, the giving of oneself for the other. There are lots of ways in which we can demonstrate that love for one another. The ways in which we call one another just to check in. The ways in which we share meals with one another. The ways in which we are just present for each other. That's one way. The ways in which we lovingly argue with one another about all kinds of things. Because when those arguments, those debates are rooted in love and respect and dignity, we can hear each other and we can learn from each other. We would be a really boring church if everybody thought the same. We would be really boring if everybody looked the same. Our church is a manifestation of God's love for us. And the ways in which we live out God's love as an example will draw more people in, will help more people want to know this same Christ that we know. But more importantly, or maybe just as important, they will want to know the God we understand that is love, love, love. So we've got some Beatle cover band folks in the church. And the Beatles did the song, All You Need Is Love. And it ends like this. All you need is love. All you need is love. All you need is love, love, love. Love is all you need. Amen. If you have been worshiping with us either online or in person when we were together, and you would like to make First Christian Church your church home, as the next song plays, All You Need Is Love, type in hashtag home in the chat if you know that you want First Christian Church to be your church home. If, however, you're still not quite sure, but you know you'd like to make a commitment to Christ, or if you've been here and you just have not been baptized and you would like to do that, type in hashtag Jesus for both of those situations, and we will be back in touch with you. So as we hear a version of All You Need Is Love, welcome home.
Two, three. Love, love, love. Nothing you can sing that can't be sung. Nothing. nothing you can say, but you can learn how to play the game. It's easy. Nothing you can make that can't be made. No one you can save that can't be saved. Nothing you can do, but you can learn how to be you in time. It's easy.
Love. And now we come to the table of love. And even though we may be apart geographically, we're together in spirit and in community as we come together to share this time of communion. Whatever you have to use as elements is perfect, is just fine, for they are all symbols, symbols of the night that we remember when Jesus was gathered together with his disciples in that upper room. They had no idea about what was about to happen, but he wanted to leave with them a promise of his love that he would be with them forever. And so he took a loaf of bread and he blessed it and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body broken for you." And in similar manner, he took a cup. And after blessing it, he said, this is given. This is my covenant to you. As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do so in remembrance of me. This is the bread of life and the cup of grace. Will you pray with me? Bless this bread and cup that we partake of. Touch our hearts with remembrance and love as we share this time together. Amen. Bread of life, cup of grace.
Abide with me. the maze, overwhelmed. Alone you prayed, your medicine, our suffering, and bore our shame. Abide with me, abide with me. Don't let me fall.
What a beautiful service. I also wanted to say again, happy Mother's Day to all of our mothers, those who are mothering, those who have been mentors in the lives of our kids here at church. I know us young mothers are really thankful for all of you. So happy Mother's Day. And I wanted to give a special shout out to Brooke, who took over for Scott today and did our slides. We're very thankful for you. Thanks for keeping it going and running smoothly. Okay, so just a few announcements. I want you guys to sign up for the Intersections. It's our weekly newsletter. You want to be a part of that. You want to know what's going on in the life of the church. You need to get that email every Thursday. If you haven't yet, sign up with Andy. You can contact her at andy@concordfcc.net. You can follow and interact with us on social media. We are at Concord FCC on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. We are also ConcordFCC.net on our website. And then we have a few things coming up this week. Like we said, happy Mother's Day. Hope you all enjoy it. Have a great Mother's Day. Hopefully you'll hear from your kids, maybe get a little treat from them. I got donuts this morning in bed. That was really nice. after the closing song, make sure you stick around. We do have our virtual coffee hour that happens every week, and it's super fun to hang out in a breakout room with some of your friends and see how everybody's doing this week. So stick around for that. You can connect with us via our mailing list or social media. We went over those. This Monday at 1:30 p.m., Disciples Women are meeting on Zoom. Tuesday at 7 o'clock in the evening, our outreach meeting is having their monthly meeting on Zoom. On Wednesday, we are doing our movie discussion at 7 p.m. on Zoom. There have been emails about that, so if you're a part of that, make sure you look for those. This coming Saturday, May 15th, is House and Grounds at 8:30, not on Zoom, in person, live. Come and join everybody at the church for helping to get our church up and running, the actual plant of the church. And May 15th is also graduation for Renee at 9 a.m. on Facebook Live. Yay, Renee! Well, that's very exciting. So definitely pray for our girl Renee as she finishes up this last week and heads into graduation. We're so proud of you, Renee. That's an amazing accomplishment. And now I'll unmute Pastor for our blessing and benediction.
Amen. Amen. So receive this benediction. Friends, imagine what is possible. Imagine what our community would feel like if our own hearts embraced the unconditional love that God has for us. Imagine what the nation would sound like if our words echoed the inclusive love God has for us. Imagine what the world would look like if our actions reflected the unwavering love of God, love God has for us. So go forth from this place to transform possibility into reality and to join alongside God in transforming the world around us in love. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. So let's go to the wider shot, the gallery view, and everybody can say goodbye. I just have two breakout rooms today because we only have about 25 people remaining online. So join us in just a moment, but everybody say goodbye.
Bye. Bye. Have a good week.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day, everybody.
Bye.
All righty.